IronCAD brings a whole new level to parametric designs by offering push and pull handles to dynamically drive your parametric models. These can be precise push and pull movements, or you can type in exact values to get the desired configurable product. IronCAD offers these handles to allow anyone to make these changes, whereas in traditional CAD systems, you would have to use Excel-like functionality to change or drive your models. With the handles, anyone can come into the system and push and pull to the desired size. So the next question is, how do you build these parametric models inside of IronCAD? So we'll go through a simple example on how to build this using the same components that you just saw. We'll start with a frame on the side, and the way IronCAD has its models is basically this is a single part that has an extrude, and if we go into its properties, it has some taper operations for its start and for the end sections to give it the nice cuts on the top and the bottom. But everything is basically driven through in a simple extrude. At the part level, you'll notice this little icon at the bottom, which is called our anchor. By default, it's set to fixed in space, which is not what we need for parametric models where we want them to dynamically move. So we need to change that by simply right-clicking on it and setting it to drag freely in space. This will allow the part to move when the handles are dragged. Next, we need to build all sides of our box, our frame, by simply clicking on our object, turning on our tri-ball, and we'll just move our tri-ball out here into space a little bit, and we'll make a linked mirrored copy to the other side. The other thing that we want to do is we want to actually add some parameters to this model. And as we can see, our model has some various set sizes already. If we go to our properties, we can see the size box already tells us that the length, width, and the height values are set to these values. What we want to do at the part level is actually just create some parameters that will drive these models later. So we'll go into our parameter table, and we'll simply add those parameters. We'll call one the side height, and we'll go ahead and set that to 1,000 for now. And we'll go ahead and add the other one for the length, which was 102. And we'll add another one for the width, which is 65.5. And for now, we'll just leave those alone. And these are automatically copied over to our other part that's linked in space. And now we'll just go ahead and create our other top and bottoms by just simply locking an axis, rotating about that axis, and we'll make a copy of that at 90 degrees. And we'll make an actual mirror of that one as well to the other side. And for this other one, we don't actually want it to be the side, so we can go to the parameters again. And actually, instead of making it the side, we'll call it the top, we'll call it the width of that object, and hit OK. Next, we want to actually lock these guys into the exact positions to make our frame. In IronCAD, one of our key philosophies is just to use the minimum amount of constraints as possible. So we just want to use some very simplistic constraints to lock this thing down, and we'll go into our assembly and go into our positioning constraints. And what we're going to create is a coincident constraint at some points. For example, we have these outside points. We'll select on those, and we'll lock that down to the outside point of this part. And when we left click, that applies that. So we can go ahead and go to the other point here to lock it down as well. And notice we picked two different points. It reversed itself. We don't want that one. We'll hit X. We can actually click that point again and actually hit the right point this time and hit lock that. So the reason we want these two points is basically to cause it or to keep it from rotating around any axis. So as long as they're locked in two directions or sort of like a plane, it will rotate. We'll just repeat the same process for all the other corners. So again, we'll go to this point up here at the top, go to our end point, lock it down there, and do the corner points as well. And we can exit out of the command to see that our top points are all locked up. We can do it again for our bottom piece here. Again, we'll zoom in, make sure we're getting to the right point. Lock that down and repeat the process. We can do the same thing on the other side. And now that we have this fully locked down, we can zoom out to see our full frame. And notice that it's all fully constrained to move correctly. The next thing we want to do is go ahead and make this an assembly. We can just box select everything here. And if we hit our S key, it'll bring up our quick access commands, and we can simply make an assembly of that. And we're also going to make another assembly, so we'll just hit the S key again and make another assembly. And we'll see in our scene browser, we have assembly one, assembly two. Assembly one is actually this frame component in the top assembly. We're just going to call it the master, our main, because we're going to actually add some blades in there later. So now that we have our frame here, how do we make this thing parametric? So as I mentioned before, what we need to do is have handles. And when we select on this, notice there's no handles on this assembly. If we go to the assembly properties and we go to our size box, we can actually turn on handles for this object. And notice it gives us a message when we click on one of these that it's actually going to enable scaling of the shape. And so the reason we want those parameters is to keep the scaling from occurring. So let's go ahead and apply these and I'll show you what I mean. So we'll go ahead and set some of the aspect locks, meaning the handles don't lock themselves together like length and width for a cylinder type movement. We're just going to set that to none. And we're also going to set it to opposite handles for the sizing behavior. And hit OK. Well, now we see our handles are now appearing on our object. If we pull these handles, notice these are actually sizing or getting thicker or scaling based on that setting, which is not what we want. What we want is those parts to remain at the fixed size that we had set. So we'll go down to our part level, go to our part properties, and to our size box tab. And if we say show formulas, you can see this is where all those scaling behaviors are being dynamically applied to the part and to the features below it. And we're going to change those to those ones that we created, which were the L, W, in this case, it was the side height. Hit OK. Then we go down to our bottom part and do the same thing. Again, turn on our formulas, change that to length, width, and this one was top width, and hit OK. And now those are physically set to not change or not scale. However, they're a fixed size right now. How do we get them to update based on the handle size? That's a simple thing as well. We just go to our parameters, and we just need to create two parameters to tie them to the handles. We'll call one as the overall height, set it to zero, and we'll add another one as overall width. And how we tie these guys to our handles is simply just ties them to the size box. So we know we want the height value to be tied to the height handle. We just type size box slash height. It'll automatically pull the value for us. We do the same thing for the other one. In this case, it's actually the width. And we pull that, it automatically pulls that as well. Last, we just need to tie these two parameters to be set by our parameters we just created. So there's our width, which is overall width, and our height, which is overall height, and those will drive those. So the nice thing about these expressions, you can drive variables in here as well as if you had math equations and things like that, you can all automatically set those in here. But right now, it's not necessary for this. We'll just go ahead and hit OK. And now, when we pull our handle, we'll see our object automatically size and position based on whatever values we're applying. Notice the size on the height and bottom are automatically positioning and sizing. We can type in exact values as we mentioned before. So if we wanted that to be 1200 for the height, maybe the width we want it to be 1000, we can drive those dynamically. So we basically set up our basic structure for our handles and our dynamic and sizing based on those handles for our frame. The last thing we need to do is go ahead and add our blade to that. And the blade is a very simple part. If we drag and drop that out, we'll see all this is, again, is a simple extrude in this case, and we just need to set its overall height for that value and position it. And we also know this is actually a pattern, so this is a simple thing to do. Turn on the tri-ball, go ahead and move it up, and create a linear pattern. Now, in my case, I'll start with 3. I know the spacing for this is going to be set at 87. We'll apply that. So now that we have a pattern, we can now position this guy into the exact location for the part. So we'll just select down to our part, again, go to our position constraints. In this case, we'll have to actually add a few in here to lock this guy into the proper location. We're going to go ahead and align it over to our front face first to move that. And next, we actually want to move the face, which is kind of right behind there at the moment. So let's go ahead and hit apply to apply that. Let's move this out a little bit so we can actually get to our face that we need to use. There we go. Now we can go back into our tool. And we actually want to do a mate on this face. So we're going to mate one of these faces to our inside face. And we want to give that an offset. And we notice it's mated right on that face. We actually give it a spacing of, let's say, 5. And you'll notice it goes different directions. A positive, we'll move it to the right. We want it to go negative, put a negative 5 there. Hit apply, that'll offset it from that face. You can actually see it's giving us a nice little distance spacing there. We'll go ahead and apply that constraint. And we'll do the same for the bottom of our part. Go ahead and mate that down to the bottom face. Sorry for the movement. We'll move it down there as well. And we can see that it's actually spaced again with that units of 5 for us. and we'll go ahead and apply that constraint. So now we have all of our constraints tied to our parameter, or to our blade here, tied to our frame, so it'll actually move with it, but we haven't set any equations for it to size automatically yet. And also, we need to set an equation for it to properly pattern based on the height of the model. So in our case, we know that these side values, if we go ahead and measure those, let's do a quick measurement, are 38 units. So we need this length to be the overall length of the entire assembly, minus 38 times 2, minus the 2 5 values, minus 10. So we can simply create a parameter again. In this case, we'll just drive the IntelliShape feature, go to the parameters, add a simple parameter here. We'll call it blade length. So length. Hit OK. And we know this parameter expression, we're going to need to be see all these values inside of here. So we know this blade length needs to be the overall width of the part minus 38 times 2, which is 76, plus 10, so we'll make that 86 millimeters. So if we tie that and hit apply, nothing happens yet because we haven't actually tied that to the feature yet. So we'll go to our feature, go to our IntelliShape properties, to the size box, and that height value, we just simply make that blade. And hit OK, and you'll see that update, and all of our patterns update automatically for us. Lastly, we need to make the parameter expression to drive the number of blades on this part. So we have a pattern, parameters are automatically added when you create those in IronCAD. All we need to do is set expressions for those. So what we know is we need to know the overall height of this divided by the number, the blade spacing, or the distance. You can think of that as a pitch, for example. And we'll just add an extra unit to that. We want that to be a scalar value. You always need to have a physical number there. So we're going to make an integer for this guy. I'm going to say the overall height divided by the distance minus one unit. We can type out of there. That's going to give us an equation of 12. When we go ahead and apply to that, you can see our pattern automatically updates. So now, if we zoom out and pull our handle, we'll see everything sized properly for us, both in the width and the height size, to give us a dynamic parametric model. So that's basically the basic functions to create your parametric models. And the only thing you need key to note is when you create these parameters down at the part levels, you may have to go to the feature level if you have multiple features underneath your part to set up those parameters. In my case, I only had one feature, so I can drive it at the part level. And notice on the blades, I drove it at the feature level. So you have multiple options in IronCAD to drive or set those parameters. But if you do drive it at the feature level, you want to make sure your part parameters are also not controlled by any variables. So setting those to zero or setting those to the exact values at the end would be the best way to get this to work properly with the assembly handles. Again, this is a very short demonstration. I hope you enjoyed it. To set up a parametric driven model by handles using the size box handles of the assemblies of IronCAD. I hope you enjoy.